So please mute your microphones, and today we shall be discussing our eighth book that deals with Victorian age. So dear learners, our discussion will be carried over to Victorian age from Romantic age. So before Romantic age, we had discussed Augustan age, and we had a basic difference. We found a basic difference between the Romantic age and Augustan age, so far as the poetic trends are concerned. And we had discovered that when Augustan age, dealing with the intellectual aspect of literature, the Romantic age dealt with the emotional aspect. The primary concern of the subject matter of the Augustan age was town or urban area, society, people, whereas that of the Romantic age was in nature, study of nature in relation to man, obviously associated with the rural or rustic life, rural life. So that was a kind of migration or escape from the society to nature. So the trend of Romantic poetry had its influence, even though not entirely, but slightly, on the Victorian poetry. I mean, some sort of romantic elements we do find here, but Victorian poetry is not entirely of nature, because even though it followed some of the techniques, some of the poetic trends of Romantic age, not all, but some, it again shifted its attention from nature to society. So the society which has been ignored or which has been neglected by the Romantics, which was emphasized upon by the Augustan, that again that spirit was revived in Victorian age. But Victorian age is not entirely, I mean, society concern, or it is an age in which both romantic trends as well as the modern trend is there, because our next class will be on the modern poetry. So we may say that Victorian poetry is a link between the romantic poetry and the modern poetry. So some sort of romantic elements and some sort of modern elements we can find in the Victorian poetry. So this Victorian age is so, I mean, important in the history of English literature, that it was an age when novel flourished a lot, the form of novel. So you will discuss it in your MAG 3 class about novel. So let us have an exact historical background to the Victorian age. So Victorian age has been recorded as a period between 1837 to 1901. I'm repeating it. Victorian age has been recorded as a period from 1837 AD to 1901 AD. So obviously, this has a political linkage, because historical linkage, because 1837 AD is the year when Queen Victoria ascended the throne of England. So Victorian age is obviously named after Queen Victoria. So the age continues from Queen Victoria's ascending the throne of England till her death in 1901. So that is where this is Victorian age. So the Victorian age in English literature has been named after the ruler of England, it is Queen Victoria. So that is the naming of the age. But when you come to the historical aspects, because as we discussed in our earlier classes, that always the society has been tremendously influenced by the historical facts, the social facts, the cultural facts of the period, and again those events taking place in history, they have the tremendous influence on the literary aspects, as a result of which we find the trend of literature changes in every form. It may be drama, it may be poetry, or it may be novel, etc. and etc. So the beginning of the Victorian age in 1832 AD, we find there the introduction of a reform bill. The age is important in that aspect that after Queen Victoria ascended the throne, there was the introduction of a reform bill in the British Parliament. And the reform bill was meant for the civil liberties of the British people. I mean, some political changes, some change in the civil code of conduct of the common people of England took place in 1832. So, as a result of the introduction of a reform bill in 1832, and the bill became an act, as you know, when a bill is presented in the parliament and it gets the approval, it becomes the act. So after that reform act in 1832 and 1832, we find it gave rise to another movement in England called Chartist movement, Chartist, Chartist movement. The Chartist movement continued between 1837 to 1848. So the Chartist movement was a movement by the working class people particularly. It was a political movement, and the movement was aiming at the sanction of franchise to the working class people, franchise and retaining of property in their name. So the Chartist movement, chart means chatter, we say chatter of demand. When there is a strike or something like that, dharana, something like that, there is a chatter of demand placed before the government. So this demand is called chatter. Chatter means a list of demand. So from that word chatter, it is Chartist movement. So this Chartist movement initiated by the working class people was particularly for two demands. One was approval of or sanction of franchise. Franchise means the power to cast your vote for franchise, to take active part in the democratic procedure of the nation. So any doubt? Someone has unmuted the microphone. Okay, so please mute it. Someone has unmuted. So please mute your mic. Okay. So the Chartist movement, that the political movement that changed the condition of the poor people under the demand, and the condition of the poor people or working class people during that Victorian period was very much reflected in The novels, when you discuss novels, you will get it. The novelists like George Eliot or Middlemarch, then Charlotte Bronte, or novel the Jane Eyre or Charles Dickens, Hard Times, or William Makepeace Thackeray's Vanity Fair, or Emily Bronte's Wuthering Heights. These are the novels which very much describe the situation of the working class people in England. Anyway, 1832 witnessed the Chartist movement, and there was a reformation taking place in the exercise of franchise and retaining the property in the name of the poor. The movement that took place. So obviously, the Reformation Act, okay, successively invited another two reform. The Reformation Bill 1 was introduced in 1832. Then there was the Chartist movement, and again in 1837, and again 1872 and 1884, we find there are another Reformation bills introduced in the British Parliament. So those bills, those reform bills, because I gave these years to you, because all these movements, all the reformations, they come under the British period, I mean the Victorian period. So these successive reform bills, they ensure democracy, prosperity, and a stable society in England. I'm repeating it. The succession of reform bills and
Sir,
the yes.
please repeat again. Chartist movement.
Chartist movement means Chartist movement that took place in 1837 as a consequence of the introduction of reform bill in 1832 after Queen Victoria ascended the throne. The purpose and the reform bill was mainly meant for the upliftment of the poor people or working class people to a standard in the British society or in the English society. So getting a scope from it, the Chartist movement started in England. Chartist movement was that movement took place in England in 1830s from 1837 to 1848. A long period. It was a political movement done by the working class people, and the purpose of the movement was a kind of revolution. The movement was for two basic reasons: that the grant of power of franchise means power to cast vote, exercise franchise, and the second one is the approval of retaining property or getting property in their name in record. But that was not granted to the working class people in the earlier British society. So this movement is called Chartist movement because this has come from the word chatter. Chatter means a list of demands. So those group of people, when they proposed for this or when they went for that, then this movement is called Chartist movement. I think, and this movement, the reflection of this Chartist movement is very much reflected in several of the novels during the Victorian period. In your MEG3, probably you will get a lot of information about this Chartist movement and the Makepeace Thackeray or Emily Bronte, etc., etc. So that is the novels were very much reflecting those ideas. So what I am trying to say here is, under which political social situation, so Victorian literature was marked by a spirit of reconciliation and compromise, because it was a peculiar period, because you'll find that when in one aspect the British society or the British Parliament or the British society, English society was ensured with democracy, ensured with prosperity, ensured with a stable society. At the same time, there were some ugly pictures which were very much there in the British society. So it was having both, I mean, beautiful and ugly pictures of its own. So that we shall discuss in the latter part, that what is that compromise, why the compromise is there. And someone was asking me in the last class about the position of women in the English society during that time. That my answer to that query was,
sir,
yes,
I asked.
Yes. My answer, sir, yes, I asked. Yes. Okay, thank you.
Yes, so I got it, sir. Charlotte Bronte, the Bronte sisters, and Jane Austen, those are the writers of the Victorian age.
And George Eliot is also a women writer. The original name is Mary Evans. So they were writing under the pseudonym. So why that was there? Because during the Victorian society, there was the prevailing idea of conservatism on the question of women's role in the society. A conservative idea dominated or predominated the English society on the question of the role of a woman in the society. So that role of a woman was voiced in the poetry, it was voiced in the prose of that period. Because let me draw your attention to page number 6 of your book 8 that you are discussing today. A beautiful poem is there which will very much make you clear about the position of women during the Victorian society. That is page number 6 of book 8. I'm reading a few lines, from that. That is, it is written that man, it is Tennyson's poem, The Princess. Okay, the Tennyson's poem, Alfred Lord Tennyson, a Victorian poet, and the poem is The Princess. It is referred to the woman. How I'm just reciting 4 lines. The first line is, man for the field, man for the field, and woman for the hearth, for the chulli, the cooking place. The man for the field, woman for the hearth, man for the sword, and for the needle, see, needle, chunchi, needle. Man with head, man with head, woman with heart. So man is referred to as an intellectual being and woman is emotional. So women are treated as sentimental, emotional, and they do not have an intellectual capability at par with male. And they are meant to cook. I mean, they are confined with the domestic responsibilities like cooking, like stitching, needle in the tea, man with the head and woman with the heart. Man to command, very interesting, man to command and woman to obey. See the line, man to command and woman to obey. So this is very interesting. What kind of picture do you get about women during the Victorian age? They were very much suppressed, they are very much underestimated, and they were not given a status at par with the human. This was a conservative idea or the conservatism. The conservatism on the question of women's role in the society was very much there. So this question was voiced in the poem of Alfred Dodgson's Princess. And another one, we shall find another poet, John Stuart Mill, and his poem, The Subjection of Women. Subjection of Women, and in that particular work, John Stuart Mill has made an elitist ideological interpretation, an elitist, educated, elitist ideological interpretation of woman's place. That what is the woman's place? He has presented in that work that woman's place I'm repeating that same line of, he's repeating probably the same line of Alfred Lord Tennyson. Woman's place is in the heart and hearth. Woman's place is in the heart and hearth. Means woman is meant to be loved, to be cared, to be cajoled, and woman is meant to take care of the domestic responsibilities like cooking food, like taking care of the children, or taking care of all domestic works of the house. And again, this question of the inferior role of a woman in the society, it was again very much epitomized by another poem of Coventry Patmore, another poet, Coventry Patmore, Coventry Patmore, Coventry Patmore, Patmore, Coventry Patmore, from 1823 to 1896. In his poem, the look at the title of the poem will be very, it is interesting. The title of the poem is The Angel in the House. The Angel in the House. I mean, when the poet is epitomizing, when the poet is admiring, when the poet is appreciating the woman as a, with the word angel, the agent of God, at the same time, he is confining that angel in the house. So that is the angel in the house. So, and another poem of John Ruskin, another poet, John Ruskin, the title of the poem is Of Queen's Garden. And Queen's Garden, so in that particular poem, Queen's Garden, the Victorian, how it has reflected that the Victorian society was very much valuing, giving importance on the purity and chastity of the woman. That people expected women to be pure.
Hello.
Yes. Yes.
Sir, page number.
I repeat. Page number. Number? Page number 6 of book 8.
Yes, sir.
Page
yes,
number. I'm discussing 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So that poem I presented before is in the page number 6. And these poets I'm giving the names, that is not in the book, that I'm giving from extra information, as you extra information. Okay. So.
Yes,
that the angel in the house and angel in the house and of Queen's Garden, the words like angel, the words like queen, they are very much given to the women to appreciate them, to love them and to express them, that they are the object of love, they are the object of enjoyment, and they are the object of taking domestic responsibility, take care of the house, children, etc. But at the same time, a woman is idealized on the basis of her purity and chastity. A woman should be chaste, means she should be pure in heart, she should be pure in body, she should be pure in mind. So it was a kind of restrictions that was imposed upon the women of the period. In Victorian period, the women did not have a chance to retain the status at par with the men. That is the reason for which some of the women novelists, they wrote their novel under the pseudonym, and that was the question of women. So in the Victorian age. Now, after the Chartist movement, the Reformation Bill, or the position of women, one more important historical factor that I would like to bring before you, that is the Oxford movement. Oxford movement took place between, is very important in the sense that this Oxford movement is actually a central theme of all Victorian productions of literary manifestations. All literary works of the Victorian age were influenced by the question of, by the debate of the Oxford movement. Oxford is a university, you know very well. So Oxford movement that took place between 1833 to 1841. So it is called Oxford movement because During that Oxford moment, a speech was delivered by John Cable, J-O-H-N, John, K-E-B-L-E, Cable. John Cable, who was a professor in the Oxford University. So the Oxford University professor, John Cable, he delivered a speech on the apostasy. Apostasy means that is about it is apostasy means the abandonment of religion, to quit religion, to leave religion. Religion ko chhadi dao, to quit religion. So apostasy, the abandonment of religion. And what does he say? That which is very, it is very important for the Victorian literature. That how can you live? What is religion? Religion means a way to maintain your life. When you obey a particular way to maintain your life, then you follow a religion, because a religion gives us some guidelines, some ethical guidelines, some moral guidelines, some spiritual guidelines under the name of some God or scripture, so that we can make our life, put our life in a particular tract to make it meaningful or to make organized. So now John Cable argued in his speech that what a person is not bound to follow a religion. So that is apostasy. So he says that religion should not be objective. Religion should be subjective. Religion should be personal. Religion should be personal on the basis of subjective exploration and interpretation of theology. But what is happening in our society? If I born to a Christian family, then I am Christian. I don't have a scope to choose my religion. If I am born in a Muslim family, I am a Muslim. I don't have the scope to choose my religion. So the Oxford University professor, he delivered on his speech on the apostasy. That is, you can abandon religion, you can quit religion, and you can make your own exploration, you can make your own petition of the theological ways life to choose. So in that way, he criticized two elements of religion, that is the Erastian and Luditarianism. Erastian, E-R-A-S-T-I-A-N, Erastian. Erastian means tolerance of other people's religious views. You have to tolerate the views of other people. So he says, why to tolerate? Why not to argue? Why not to counter? Why not to debate the idea of the other? Why should you compromise with that? So that is called Erastian view. And another is Luditarianism. Luditarianism means the tendencies, lacking moral or religious principle. Lack of moral and religious principles. So these two things, that is Erastian and Luditarianism, the two things were highly criticized by the professor John Cable. And these had a tremendous influence in the society. So he directly criticized the tendencies of the church, that why to believe, why to accept, why to surrender, why to compromise whatever the church is propagating, whatever the church is preaching, and all that. So for the first time, we find that there was a challenge, or there was a direct encounter with the ideology of the church, with the theological perspectives of the church. And two things he made: that religion should be personal, religion should be based on your personal exploration, personal interpretation of the theology or your existence in the society. And the second thing is that why shall we tolerate, why shall we accept the views of others without any debate, without any argument, without any logic? What he said, Erastian. And the third thing is that Latitudinianism. So Latitudinianism means that why there should be lack of moral and religious principles in your life. So let it be. that let whatever religion, let it be personal, let it be subjective. So religion must not be objective. So it raised an important question on the on religion, particularly two sects of religion in that period, that is Roman Catholicism and Protestantism. So this Oxford movement that took place between 1833 to 1814, you can get it in the page number 7 of book 8, what I discuss. This Oxford movement, you can find it in your work, in your text. It is also referred to as Tractarian movement. Oxford movement is also referred to, it also known as the Tractarian movement. Tractarian movement. That is, you see that Oxford movement took place between 1833 to 1841. So during this period, 1833 to 41, almost 8 years, this is also referred to as a Tractarian movement. And this Tractarian movement, it has come from the word that is tracts, T-R-A-C-T-S, tracts. Tract means treaty, T-R-E-A-T by treaty or discourse, treaty or discourse. So why it is Tractarian? Because tracts for the time, treaty for the time, understanding for the time, discourse for the time. So because of that idea, the movement in the Oxford, it is Oxford because in the name of John Keble, the professor of Oxford University, initiated it. But it is also otherwise called Tractarian movement because it was emphasizing on the tracts of the time, the treaty of the time, the discourse of the time. So what was the discourse? What was the treaty? The treaty was, treaty, you know, sandhi, understanding, compromise. The treaty was sought to link the Anglican Church more closely to the Roman Catholic Church. That was to make a treaty, to make a pact between, to make an understanding between both the churches, that is Roman Catholic churches and the Anglican or Protestant churches. I mean, it wanted to make a compromise between the newer values and the traditional values, the earlier values and the new values of the society, the Protestant values of the society. So these are some of the important factors that was taking place during the Victorian period. So you can get in your text in page number 10 that there is a term used for Victorian complacence. Victorian complacence. So Victorian complacence or Victorian compromise. That is in page number 10, we'll be finding that what is that complacence or what is that compromise or Victorian complacency, you may say. That you know that Victorian age is an age of progress, as you discussed. It is an age of stability. Okay. It is an age of social reforms. So people were complacent. The Victorian people were complacent. So what is complacent? Complacent means a feeling of contented self. A feeling of contented self-satisfaction from all respect. But suppose you think of the present situation, yourself. You have everything. You have a good house. You have a stable earning. You have a good family. Everything is okay. Then sometimes you feel contented. Sometimes you feel the self-satisfaction, but you can be self-satisfied, you can attain contentment, self-contentment, when you are unaware of the upcoming trouble. When you think of the upcoming trouble and were aware of the upcoming trouble, then complacency cannot be attained. So the Victorian people were complacent, or there was a complacency in the Victorian age, because the Victorian people were contented with self-satisfaction, but they were not aware of the upcoming troubles. The upcoming troubles were realized at a later stage. So in the Victorian age, you will find that the self-complacency of the people on the basis of progress, stability, social reforms in all respect, that was troubled by some newly emerging factors. And the earlier progress, stability and social order had to compromise with the new order. So the people during that age, they were in a dilemma, they were in a doubt, they were in an anxiety, at the same time they were in a despair to adjust themselves with this Victorian compromise. So you may call it an antagonistic reconciliation. It is a reconciliation, it is a compromise, but it is not a suitable compromise. When the compromise is not suitable, the compromise can be antagonistic. So we may call this Victorian compromise as an antagonistic reconciliation between what? Antagonistic reconciliation between older ideas and the new ideas. So what are those older ideas and new ideas? That we shall very much explore in our further discussions. That is, we have already noted that the Victorian age is an age of progress, stability, social reform, etc., etc. But dear learners, at the same time, we must not ignore the fact that Victorian age was also characterized by poverty, injustice, and social unrest. So, what do we find here? We find here a compromise between what they want to show and what they really are. What they want to show and what they really are. I mean, there was a contrast between the appearance and the reality. And the cause of this is very much linked with the Industrial Revolution. So, what exactly we mean by Industrial Revolution? Industrial Revolution is not a revolution like French Revolution, because one of the meanings of revolution is a significant change or a significant development in a particular field. We can say the invention of cell phone is a revolution.
Green revolution, yellow revolution, blue revolution, all these.
Yes. So revolution is a significant change in some particular field. Your mobile phone is a revolution in the field of communication, you may say. So industrial revolution is not exactly a revolution. However, it was a big change, remarkable change, significant change in the field of industry. So prior to industrial revolution, the industries were small scale. Small scale means having small volume of production. And industry you are confined with only the production of textile and flour, F-L-O-U-R, flour, atta. Industry was confined with flour and textile. And industry was bound to be established. Industries were available only on the bank of the river because of the transportation of goods, and secondly, the power it was powered by the windmills. But after the invention of steam engine by James Watt, the face of industry changed. that the steam power was used in the industries, and it was not necessary to settle an industries on the bank of the river. You can settle industry anywhere, and you can run industry through steam power, and transportation could be made through the wagons, railway wagons, and coal was also excavated by the use of steam power. And as a result of which, the volume of production of the industry changed. So industry became small scale to large scale, so, and it was not no more confined with floor and textiles. Many things were produced. So when industries were established anywhere, we can find there was the establishment of industrial towns. So after the industrial revolution, we find the establishment of industrial towns, and Manchester is the first industrial town. So when an industrial town was established, it needed workers, and many people migrated from different sectors to work there as the workers. So a cosmopolitan society was created. A cosmopolitan society was formed because workers from different places, they went there to work in different capacities, from the higher position to the lower position, the workers. So this is the so people became rich. Their wages were increased. They had a better condition to live and all that. But at the same time, industrial revolution, in the field of economy was also improved. It's okay, fine. But at the same time, there was an ugly face of industry. What was the ugly face of industry? The ugly face of industry was that it created pollution, it created disease, and the most ugly contribution of industrial revolution is slum. Slum was created in the town. So slum, jhopadpatti area, where the workers live in a very unhygienic condition and a very peculiar atmosphere is there. So in the slum, so when there was slum, there was disease, there was death, there was also unhygienic condition and all that. So the impact of industrial revolution that we find in the society that gave rise to so many things. So at one hand, you talk about the prosperity of science and technology, but at the same time, you cannot ignore the ugly face of industrial revolution. The slum, that is the unhygienic condition, that is the pollution, that is the debt, that is the division, etc. So how to make a reconciliation? So obviously, the reconciliation cannot be good. The compromise cannot be good. Reconciliation is an antagonistic one. So that is one example. So in that situation, the writers of the age, you can very much find the idea presented in the novels of Thomas Hardy, Hard Times, and that is there. And significantly, one more important thing that I want to highlight on you, that is probably the most important thing, that is conflict between science and religion. Victorian age is very well known for, it is significantly identified with a typical feature or a typical characteristics of the time, that is the conflict between science and religion. Why the conflict between science and religion? People were unable to decide which is right, whether science is right or religion is right. And why that took? So obviously, there was a question of anxiety to know, there was a question of despair or depression to develop doubt on the traditional way in which they had been living with. This took place because of the publication of a very notable work, significant work of the time, that is The Origin of the Species by Charles Darwin. The book Origin of the Species by Charles Darwin, that was published in 1859. The exact date is
Hello, sir.
That, yes.
Sir, in which page these are mentioned?
It is mentioned in page number. Let me give you the page number. Page number. Just a minute. Wait. I'm giving it. It is in that introductory section. It is there from page number 10 to 23. You will get somewhere exactly. And right now I cannot. You can find it. It is there in the introductory section. It will find. You will find it. Okay.
Can you say the books and
book eight.
No, huh. No,
you can.
Now find, you are saying your books and
author of the book. Yes, I am repeating it once again. You will find it in page number 11. Okay, page number 11.
Okay.
Page 11, book 8. Okay. So the conflict between science and religion was an outcome due to the publication of a book. The name of the book is The Origin of the Species by Charles Darwin. The book was published, The Origin of the Species by Charles Darwin. The book was published in 1859. The exact date of publication is 24th November 1899. So that book very much emphasized upon the evolution of life on the earth. So you see that when you are discussing Milton, that what was the traditional belief of the people, or the religious belief of the people, that since the time immemorial, people had a traditional belief that man is created by the God, that Adam and Eve episode, you know it, the Genesis story of the Bible, that our first father and mother, that is Adam and Eve, they were created by the God, and God created them in his own image. I mean, suddenly God created a man, that is Adam, and God created a woman, that is Eve, and he sent them to the earth. And you know the Satan story. Then from then, the next generation came, and now we are living on the earth. But this idea, this biblical concept of the creation of human being, the creation of man, the woman, is vehemently challenged by Charles Darwin in his book, The Origin of Species. The Origin of Species very clearly explained with all scientific evidence that man and woman or human being is never created in the image of God, or human being is never created all of a sudden like Adam and Eve. Because life on the earth, life on this planet was created by a natural process of evolution. So life was started on this planet in the form of a jelly in water. So from that jelly, there was a gradual process of evolution, and for millions and millions of years, and in the process of evolution, we find there were water animals, or what we call aquatic animals. So water animals or aquatic animals, they remained for a long time in water, who came to this earth through the series of evolutions. And some of the water animals, they came to land. And when they came to land, some remained in the land and some returned to the water. So again, the animals who came to the land, then some of them permanently remained in the land, they became the land animals, and some of them remained in the land as well as in water, like snake, like frog and all that. They became the amphibians. They can remain in the water, they can be aquatic, they can be land. So we got three types of now species. First type of species were the water animals, aquatic animals. The second type of species were the amphibians, both lived in water and land. And the third type of species were the land animals, and man is a land animal. So man did not come to the earth all of a sudden, because again those land animals who had come to land from water and originated in the form of jelly, they remain on the land for millions and millions of years, and after their genetic transformations, evolutions, we find the monkeys or the apes, and those apes again through the series of evolutions ultimately attended the figure of human being. Again, we have different types of human beings, the Neanderthal and all those. So, origin of species. Species means kinds of animals. How they originated on this planet? That was very scientifically proved by. That was very scientifically, debated by, argued by Charles Darwin. So, this argument was so packed with evidences. Or this was such an there was such evidential explanations were there that people were in doubt, because when you had been when we are under the impression that something is taking place, the biblical note of that Adam and Eve, and all of a sudden you are very much informed with a new idea, then it is obviously a trouble for us, a confusion for us, a dilemma for us, and we cannot immediately abandon the idea, earlier idea, what has been taught to us by the Bible, Holy Bible. And at the same time, we cannot ignore the new idea because it is scientifically proved. So the origin of species, that created the confusion in the mind of the people and the mind of the common man. So in the Victorian poetry, you find that the conflict between science and religion, that was very much that was a dominant literary aspect in the Victorian literature, because the common man, now they became scientific, they gradually become scientifically aware for every question, for every argument, for every logic, for every debate. They asked question, why and how, why it is happening, how it is happening. So this was a scientific approach towards life that was generated in the mind of the common people because of the publication of the Origin of Species by Charles Darwin. So in this situation, when you are put in a doubt, what to accept, what to reject, then obviously your complacency, your self-satisfaction, everything is okay and I am living happily, that will be vehemently disturbed. So this complacency of the Victorian people were that was disturbed due to this introduction of new ideas of science. You can very much find this expression, that self-satisfaction of the people, the self-complacency of the people, were challenged with the new idea of skepticism. Skepticism, you understand that you will not believe what has been told to us without any proof. It is a kind of antagonism towards the religious views. So that is, self-satisfaction was replaced with skepticism. Because when you go to the poem of Alfred Lord Tennyson, the most dominating poet of this Victorian age, Alfred Lord Tennyson, in his poem In Memoriam, that In Memoriam is an elegy written on the death of his college friend Arthur Hallam. Arthur Hallam died very young, at the age of probably 21. So when they were studying in the same college. So the poet Alfred Tennyson wrote the poem In Memoriam, or in the memory of the death of his friend Arthur Hallam. And that poem is very, very crucial one, because that particular poem surveyed the entire history of mankind from the time of creation. And what kind of survey? The survey of the conflict between science and religion. Religion, which is older than science. Of course, science is there, but discovery of scientific facts, discovery of scientific idea, was a newer aspect to the society. So how that challenged, how that replaced the religious beliefs of the people, that was very anxiously, discovered, surveyed by Tennyson. Then one more book, which was very much crucial, important for the age of Victorian poetry to turn the mode, to turn the tide into a different direction. That was the publication of a book by David Friedrich. The name of the book is The New Life of Jesus. Look at this title, The New Life of Jesus by David Friedrich. F-R-I-E-D-R-I-C-H, David Friedrich. The David Friedrich book, The New Life of Jesus. Okay? The New Life of Jesus, it criticized the concept of Bible. What is written in the Bible? The criticism of the Bible that it describes the spiritual uncertainty and bewilderment of Victorian. Yes, yes, I'm listening. It describes the spiritual uncertainty and bewilderment. Please switch off your microphone. Please mute your microphone. Someone is continuously talking so that it will be easier for me to discuss. So the book, The New Life of Jesus by David Friedrich, that criticized the Bible with a Victorian outlook. Then what was the subject that that the book brought? Because that book brought spiritual uncertainty and bewilderment, astonishment, surprise in the Victorian England. So you find that the Victorian society was marching towards a new direction, that it was an age to, you cannot reject the older idea, you cannot accept the new one. So they are to remain in between these two. So the hope in God, the faith in God, the confidence in God, that became weaker in a Victorian society than before. Because the concept of God was challenged, the faith in God was doubtful. So God became a weaker concept in the Victorian theology, in the Victorian literature. The confidence in the Bible that teaches God was put under suspicion. Even it was abandoned. Even it was questioned. Even it was made, it was put under debate. So there was not entirely a rejection or an acceptance of the both earlier and new idea. But you can very well find that the concept of God became weaker and the teaching of Bible also became confused or became doubtful. So these ideas, the concept of God getting weaker and the confidence in the Bible was gone because it was fetched with some doubt and despair that was expressed in some of the beautiful poems written by the Victorian poet, that is Matthew Arnold. So Matthew Arnold's two major poems, it is there in your text. If you look, one is the Dover Beach. Another one was the Polar Gypsy. Dover Beach, D-O-V-E-R, Dover Beach, Samudra Kola, B-E-S-H, Beach, and the Scholar Gypsy, S-C-H-O-L-E-R, Scholar Gypsy, G-U-I-P-S-Y, Gypsy. Gypsy is a tribe, the Scholar Gypsy. They demonstrate, these two poems, they very beautifully demonstrate the conflict and confrontation between science and religion. Why and how? Prove it, then establish it. If not, doubt prevails, doubt continues, confusion continues. So there was an intellectual confusion continued in the mind of the Victorian people, and it was very clearly reflected in the Victorian poems. And the religious skepticism, the disbelief towards religious doctrines, the rejection towards religious doctrines, that was inherited. So now, dear our learners, from where did the Victorians inherit the religious skepticism? If you remember, then this is somehow inherited from the romantics. Because in some of the romantic poems we discussed in our earlier class, that romantic poets, they except Wordsworth, romantic poets, they also inherited, they also had some sort of skeptic attitude in some of their poems. So the skepticism is not entirely a new discovery or
sir, then what is the basic difference between romantic poets and Victorian poets?
Discussion that Victorian people are remaining in between the romantics and the modern poets. They are a link between romantic age and modern age. So you will find that some sort of romantic elements are very some sort of romantic. I'm talking about a similarity first. Some sort of romantic elements are there. What is that? The treatment of subject matter, the treatment of poetic style, ornamental style, or sometimes the treatment of the Titian style, sometimes the treatment of let's say Byronic style, that is there in the Victorian poetry. But the basic difference between the Victorians and the romantic poets is that romantic poets, they deal with the rustic rural life, that is nature, but the Victorian poets, they do not talk about nature. Even if they talk about nature, that nature. Oh, someone has unmuted the microphone. Please mute it. Please mute the microphone. Okay. So the basic difference is that when they emphasize on nature, the natural phenomenon, that not the society, the Victorian poetry deal with social affairs. So again, the romantic poets who had left society and gone to nature, it is again restored in the Victorian age. So they deal with society, romantic poets, they deal with nature. So, but in some of the poems of Victorian poets, you can find the treatment of nature is there. For example, I'm giving you the name of a poem, that is The Brook. It is also taught in class 7-8 also. The brook, B-R-O-O-K, brook. Brook means a small stream. So the brook is very much in a poem of nature, but this brook can never be treated as a romantic poem. Even if the brook is a part of nature, it is a nature poem, the brook is very much described by Alfred Lord Tennyson in relation to the society. The brook is never exclusively presented as a natural object or some part of nature, but the brook is presented here as a part of the society. How is it linked with the society and social affairs? How it is a witness to the Victorian society, that is there. So Victorian, so some sorts of romantic elements you find there, but it is different from romantic poem, because here the brook or the river or the stream, whatever you may say, it is not exclusively treated as a romantic object. It is treated as a Victorian object. The brook is here the witness of the society in that relation. So, because society is more important here, the society is focused through that brook. So that is the difference. The society, there is nature, but some trends of romantic quality, like skepticism. This is inherited from the romantic poets, like use of some words, expressions, and Titian style in the poem of Tennyson. If I will discuss that one a little, then because that is in your text also. So if you allow, then I'm repeating. I'm just taking a small stanza of the brook in page number 13 of your book 8. The brook, yeah, the you see the stanza, first stanza is, the brook is here the in the poem in the first person point of view. The spokesman is here, the brook itself. The brook is speaking. What does the brook say? That the poem is autobiographical, because the speaker of the poem is the brook itself. I come from haunts of coot and heron. I make a sudden sally and sparkle out among the fern to bicker down the valley. If you look at the language of the poem, then what is the brook saying? The brook is saying that I pass through different places. So I pass through different places. And when I pass through different places, what are these places? which places are very much the part and parcel of society. That means I am a witness to the society, and I am a witness to the society not today. I am a witness to the society from the time immemorial, because I represent time. I have no beginning, I have no end, but I am the witness to the changes of the society. So here the brook is a witness to the changes that is taking place in the society, and today the brook is witnessing the Victorian society. So in the further part of the poem, you'll find the brook as a witness to the Victorian age, the doubt, the chaos, the confusion, the compromise, the doubt, all those things are there. But the style of writing of the poem, it's Keatsian style. Because we discussed in the earlier class that Keats' imagination or Keats' romantic poem are based on sensuous objects. Five senses will be appealed to that. So even the word is, I sparkle out among the fern. Sparkle, the word sparkle. So it is giving a sensuous approach to your eyes. Sparkling, sparkle out among the ferns. And I look at the word, I bicker down the valley. So when water is bickered down, it is creating a sound effect. So your ear is being aroused with that sensuous approach of the bicker down. So the Christian style is there. So it is a romantic style. So style is romantic. It's one example, but the theme or approach is Victorian. So that you can find, though, that is some similarities and some contrast and contrast and comparison between the Victorian poems and the romantic poems. So one of such elements, I think I have made some of your doubt clear. So this religious skepticism was inherited by the Victorians from the romantic poets. Then obviously religion, so as I told you, the Oxford movement that abused that religion became the subjective experience, and it was not the objective experience. Religion was not an objective item, not an objective spiritual item for the Victorian people. It was a subjective item for the Victorian people or of Victorian poets. And also, you can find here the important point is the utilitarian view of nature and philosophy. Utilitarian view. The nature was not idealized here, unlike the romantic people. There is no idealization of nature. Rather, nature is viewed from its utilitarian aspect. Utilitarian means the behavior, the pragmatic aspect, the practical aspect, how nature can be used practically for the benefit of mankind, for the broader aspect of mankind. So these are some of the important points so far as the Victorian poetry is concerned. And if we put our attention to have a systematic discussion on the salient features or the characteristics of Victorian poetry, then we have already noted three important points. That the first important point is that it was an age of compromise, reconciliation. The second point is that there was a contrast, or there was a confusion, or there was a, conflict between science and religion. What is right and what is wrong, the original obsession, all that. And again, you can find a third element, that the concept of God became weaker, and the preaching of Bible became doubtful. The people, the common man, were in doubt to accept or to reject the preaching of the Bible. So obviously, it generated a new question on the establishment of the church. Because when you find the Victorian age, then it was an age of cultural upheavals, radical changes, focusing on sensory elements, and the religious and scientific conflict.
Sir, cultural what?
Cultural upheavals. Development. Upheavals. Upheavals. Cultural upheavals. Radical changes. Fundamental changes. Okay. And focus on sensory elements. not sensory elements which can be practically available to you.
So as you said that this was the beginning of the doubt of the in Victorian period, people were having doubt on the religion. So can we say that the modern period is, I mean, the doubt which people have of existential crisis in modern period was the beginning from the Victorian age itself?
I told you that Victorian age is the link between romantic and modern. So obviously in the modern age you find the decline of religious faith. So the decline on the religious faith that started in Victorian age. And how did it start? It started because of the publication of two important books. One was The Origin of Species and another one was that I told you, The New Life of Jesus. New Life of Jesus. So this is a beginning towards the modernism. So because Victorian age is just a link between that two. So it is an age of transition. It is an age of compromise. It is an age to begin a new literary trend, which will be carried over to the modern age or postmodern age. Okay. So through that cultural upheavals or through that radical changes, we find that emphasis was given not on the subject of idealism, rather emphasis was given on the subject of realism. So no realism, no romanticization or no idealization of the society. No romanticization, no idealization of the society. They presented the society with all its ugliness and all its beauty, whatever was available to them, through the sensory explanation, through the realistic essence. So realism was another factor that we can incorporate in the literary trend of Victorian poetry. Because during the Victorian period or Victorian poetry, we can find there were two groups of Victorian poet. And one group we can call them the High Victorians, or you can divide the Victorian poetry into two sections. One is the High Victorian poetry and another is the Pre-Raphaelite poetry. Pre-Raphaelite, Pre-Raphaelite, Pre-Raphaelite poetry. So the Pre-Raphaelite group, Pre-Raphaelite was a group of poets. Pre-Raphaelite was a school against the intellectualism of Victorian age. Because what was the subject matter of, what was the purpose of the Victorian poetry? What was the purpose of Romantic poetry? Romantic poetry's purpose was to give pleasure, to give pleasure to the readers, to instruct and to, because the earlier poetry was to instruct and to please, the Augustan poetry, and Romantic poetry was to give leisure to the reader. So again, when you come to the Victorian period, we shall find the literary purpose of the poetry was not like the Romantic poetry, to create leisure. Rather, it was again, the purpose was to provide intellectual boost in the mind of the people. So I mean to instruct, to provide intellectual boost through the debatable.
Sir, it's also like social awareness.
Yes, because the role of the Romantic poets was a social reformer. The role of the Victorian poet was a social reformer. The Victorian poet was like a social activist, social reformer, because they wanted to, for them it was not art for art's sake. You understand the term art for art's sake, mean art for pleasure. It was not like that. Because romantic poems were,
it is art for life.
It is art for life's sake. But when you come to the Pre-Raphaelites, So the high Victorian poetry was aiming at art for life's sake, society's sake. But the pre-Raphaelite group of poetry, a small group
sir,
of, yes.
Sir, to provide intellectual boost to the people through what, sir?
Through the debatable topics on science and religion, because the Victorian poetry was mainly focusing on the contemporary conflict that between science and religion, what to accept and how to accept, what to reject and how to reject, because the same you will find the same thing in almost all the Victorian poems. Because when you come to the Pre-Raphaelites, were a group of poets, of course, young poets. They were identified in the year 1850. They were all below the age of 25. So that was a school, identified as a school of poets. And they said that science has nothing to do with art. Look at here. So, but the high Victorian poetry, they very much emphasized on the point that, yes, science has something to do with the art, because science is pragmatic, science is utilitarian, science is practical, science is based on experimentation, and science can challenge the question that has already been revealed in the society without any proof as a dogma. So the earlier group, the high Victorian poetry, they were giving a challenge, but the Pre-Raphaelite groups of poets, their poems were for the purpose of art for art's sake. This is the basic difference. Art for art's sake. They followed the aesthetic movement, that is art for art's sake. So actually, Pre-Raphaelite movement started with painting of some painters in 1848. Pre-Raphaelite movement through painting. And the painters, they purportedly sought to express a new moral seriousness and sincerity through their work. Their purpose was to create moral seriousness and sincere, moral, ethical, moral seriousness and sincerity in their works. And they were, because they were inspired by the 14th and 15th century Italian painters.
Sir?
Yes.
Sir, hello.
Yes.
Here I want to conclude that high Victorian poetry means that intellectuals were against the art of work. Actually, that thing.
High Victorian poetry means art for society's sake, art for the social reformation, art for.
Okay.
But Pre-Raphaelites are art for art's sake, So they had the Pre-Raphaelites. Had an admiration for what they saw as direct and uncomplicated, but the high Victorian poetry was always based on the complicated subject matters, complicated themes, and these youths of Pre-Raphaelites are the Rossettis, Dante Gabriel Rossetti, Christiana Rossetti. I think it is available to you in your page number. There is a page. It is available in your book. That is in page number. Pre-Raphaelites. It is there in your book 8. Page number is. It is probably page number 18 or something like that. Page number 18 or something like that. It is there. Pre-Raphaelites. That is Dante Gabriel Rossetti. The poet is there. Dante Gabriel Rossetti. It is there. I will give you the page number later on of the Pre-Raphaelites.
So, sir, the Pre-Raphaelites believed in arts for art's sake.
Yes, art for art's sake. They were
so
opposed.
They believed in the typical Renaissance movement. That's what you are trying to.
not exactly. Yes, you must say the Renaissance movement, because okay. They were inspired by the Italian 14th and 15th century painters. So they are somehow they are okay. Then, but the high Victorian poetry, that was not art for art's sake, but a source of inspiration or intellectual boost to the society. So, in their poems, we find some sort of pessimistic approach is there. Why pessimistic approach? Pessimistic, that is hopelessness. The pessimistic approach is there because the doubt and confusion of the time, what they dealt with, that brought despair, that brought isolation, that brought depression to their mind. Because what they witnessed in the society after the industrial revolution was slum, poverty, even unemployment, and corruption in the church, corruption in the society, disease, death, as the ugly sight of religious revolution and industrial revolution. So they expressed a kind of sentimentality, deeper form of imagination through pessimism and skepticism in their poems. So Victorian poets, they wrote about the Bohemian ideas about all these things. What is a Bohemian idea? Bohemian idea means an unconventional and non-conformist idea. Unconventional and non-conformist, that is to disobey, to discard the usual way of lifestyle. So the Bohemian idea of the high Victorian poets were and it was furthered by the imagination of the ugly sight of industrialization and corruption in both social and religious practices of the Victorian life. But the Bohemian concept, or this concept of sentimentality, deeper sense of imagination, that was typically a romantic quality, because romantic quality, the sentimental quality is very much a part of romantic poetry, the deeper sense of imagination. But when you come to the Bohemian quality, the non-conformist quality, it was typically the Augustine quality, intellectual opposition to the existing norms and regulations. So you can find here a combination of both the qualities, which went further to create a new kind of poetic technique. Because in Tennyson, we find the deeper sense of imagination of Keats, sensuousness, as I discussed the poem The Brook, some of the qualities. If you look at the poem, you will find there are the use of a lot of words which are onomatopoeic, which are alliterative, and which are assonants. So let me give you a small idea about these three words, that is alliteration, assonance, and onomatopoeia. Because that poem, Brook, typically a Victorian poem written in Christian style, of course, with the new Victorian theology, new Victorian idea, had a lot of technical qualities of John Keats, romantic qualities. One is onomatopoeia. Onomatopoeia is a verbal music created by the use of words, use of letters. It is a verbal music created through words. For example, I'm saying a word that is bicker down, sparkle, okay? So sparkle, and then the another word that is brimming, then you may say there is another, these
sir,
are the words.
Now we are discussing the methods, right?
Methods.
The methods, how they, and so there's a question in our book, the great Victorian poets lacked the fire and passion which we find in poets of the Romantic revival, but they excelled them in breadth of outlook and variety of method. If you discuss that this part, then we conclude these elements which we are discussing right now.
Yes, yes, it is there in your page number, probably 13 to 17.
Yes, sir, 13 to 17.
Okay, so that is there. So in that one, they took some of the romantic qualities, but they excelled them in the deeper sense of imagination, in the use of such ornamentations. So that in that part it is there. So,
like the combining the Bohemian idea with the Renaissance idea or the Romantic idea.
Yes, yes, that is there. You can get all these things what I'm discussing in page number 13 to 17. Okay. So so that qualities that the brook is a fine example of that quality, that because the line that is repeated there again, the for men may come and men may go, but I will go on forever. Look at the line, men may come, men may go, but I will go on forever. Who is this I? That I is the brook. The brook is a witness. The brook is the time. He is witnessing the changes that is taking place in the society, particularly the English society. So a lot of alliteration means the repetition of consonant sound again and again is the alliteration. So the alliteration is like this, I come from Hans Ta and Kut T and make I sudden Da, then end Da, then sparkle L and the and belly L. So there is a lot of repetition of the alliteration. Alliteration means the repetition of.
Sir, the spelling of onomatopoeia is
onomatopoeia. 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 Okay. Alliteration is A-L-L-I-T-E-R-A, alliteration, and assonance. Assonance means repetition of vowel sound again and again is assonance. When vowel sound is repeated, it is assonance. When consonant sound is repeated, it is alliteration. When verbal music is created, it is onomatopoeia. So if you go to the entire poem, all other poems also, you will find that kind of a verbal music and the technicalities are very much there in the poems of Tennyson. So that line that Victorians lacked the fire and passion of the poets of Romantic revival, but they excelled them in the breadth and outlook is definitely proved through these poems. So that is the two Brownings, Elizabeth Browning and Robert Browning. They were the wife and husband, Elizabeth Browning and Robert Browning. They conducted, they also expressed their Victorian poems. They also dealt with the subject matter of their love poems, love affair through verse, by tender and passionate poems, by representing how love is a secondary element in the Victorian age. Because love is given not so much in love, but love in a different concept. It is not the platonic love that the Victorian people aspired for, because in the 18th century, the definition of love was changed. Because love was considered to be an element or to be an engagement between a man and a woman for the material prosperity. So the platonic idea of love, the idealization of love was not emphasized upon by the Victorian poets. Love was taken with a materialistic vision by the Romantic poets. So if you consider all these things, then you can find there was a gradual change that is taking place in the Victorian age. So as I have been repeatedly saying you that the Victorian poetic train is a link or a bridge between the Romantic movement and the modernist movement. And the modernist movement, because the question on God, the development of empirical science, rationalism and radicalism led people to give up religious faith and they become skeptic. So skepticism continued in the further ages, that is modern and postmodern ages. So corruption in the church came into limelight. The corruption in the church defined the morality of the priests, and the morality of the priests was questioned in the religious institutions. So gradually, the responsibility of the Victorian poets, was for the social reform. I mean, they became the social activists. Then, when you come to the question of morality or ethics, then obviously, when science advances, when realism advances, when skepticism prevails, or when bohemian idea expands, or it extends in the society, then morality is compressed within them. So morality in Victorian age definitely declined. But though it declined during the Victorian era, a number of poets tried to retain this morality by encouraging the people to be honest and noble, because they never encouraged the people to lose their honesty or to lose their nobility. So though in a general sense of the term, the morality, the practice of morality was declining in the society, the Victorian poets never supported it. They rather pushed the people. They rather rationally, encouraged the people, made the people aware that morality should not be abandoned at any cost, because that retains all dignity for a human being. Then,
sir, the events of nationalism in Europe, the movements of those were, they are in the nationalism in Europe. They were started by that time, na? So
yes.
These also affect the social class of these poets.
Yes, this is affected. But morality was never declined by the Victorian poets. Even if they talked about realism, because you see, morality got nothing to do with religion and all that. It is a question of your conscientiousness. So when your conscience is working properly, then and you are convinced, then you can retain your morality, because that can stabilize the society to a greater extent. So even if the skeptic ideas, the non-conformist idea, the bohemian idea, were very much.
So then, just give one example of moral crisis.
It is not audible. Please repeat.
Sir, example of moral crisis.
Moral crisis. Okay.
Can you give one?
Yes, okay. Obviously. So moral crisis means, you see that when. We talk about, you can also come across this during your MEG3 novel section. I was just talking about the question of love. Okay, so during 18th century, the idea on love, that was a question of moral confusion. Because as we see in the poems of Spencer and all that love is legitimized, or love is granted on the moral ground only after marriage. So now, love has got nothing to do with your property or with your position and all that. But in Victorian society, when the question of love was coming, then in every novel or every poem, you will find there is no question of, or there is no discussion of a platonic love. I mean, love for the sake of your attachment or your inclination or your likeness towards a person. Love is always formulated through an impulse of social position, wealth, property, etc. I mean, love was secondary, where the materialistic prosperity was the primary one. So in that case, how can you exercise the question of morality? Because ideally speaking, love should be made on the question of moral ground. If I love somebody, I should not think of the background. I should not, because it is a question of likeness. It is based on the question of prosperity, material gain, position, power, and all that. In all the novels, you will find that.
Sir.
Okay.
But as we see in Dover Beach, it is not most probably speaking about it. Mostly speaks about physical love. So how can it be yes. on the moral grounds? I mean, they are talking about immorality, right? In Dover Beach, if
no,
we
no,
see.
In Dover. In Dover Beach, it is different. In Dover Beach, the marriage is not there. It is how the lover and the beloved, they are watching upon the situation. That is the question of Dover Beach. How the change yeah. is occurring there. The poet is not emphasizing on that particular point there. The poet is emphasizing on the question of the conflict and confrontation between the earlier epoch and the current epoch, the current period and the earlier period. That is the difference the two people are watching there. So marriage is coming in the issue of marriage is coming in most of the Victor novels. In poem, that is not discussed there. In poem, that is not there. I'm just giving an example. Someone was asking me, so I'm just giving the example. That question of morality was a secondary item there. But the poet, that is my point. Question of morality was a secondary point, but the poets never discourage the readers to get themselves away from morality. Though it declined, the poets tried to retain this by encouraging the people to be honest and noble through their poems. That they tried. Okay. So
then it can say that they were reflecting the society. They were giving didactic underlying didactic notes over there. I mean,
yes.
Indirectly, they
yes,
were trying
yes,
to
definitely.
Please the society and show the morality that needs to be maintained.
Yeah. Yes, exactly. So that was one point, the question of morality. And at the same time, we can also come across the interest in medieval myths and folklore. Interest in medieval myths and folklore, contrary to the romantics. You know, romantics are also taking some aspects or taking some, I mean, matters or taking some subject matters from the medieval myths and folklore. But the medieval, that medieval, the adoption of medieval myths and folklore was a romantic trend, romantic convention. Continued by the Victorian poets, but their interest, the treatment was different from the Romantic poets, because the Romantic poets migrated to the world, medieval world of romance or medieval world of folklore for a transitory movement, and they were exploring the aesthetic beauty through the imagination. But the Victorian group of poets, they
hello sir
yes
hello sir
hmm
folklore means
yes
folklore means folklore
folklore means the local local stories, local tales, folklore, local tales which is not literally accepted, but it is locally there, like a story of a particular region or a particular area which is widely popular among the people, but it is not widespread, it has not been widespread in the society. Localized
Loka Galpa.
So that myths and folklore, that was that subject matter of myth and folklore was definitely a continuity of the romantic tradition by the Victorian poets, but the treatment was different. When the romantic poets were migrating to that world of myths and folklore for a transitory moment of through their imagination, and they were doing it for the sake of the pleasure, but the Victorian poets, they were blending the myths and folklore with contemporary concern through a Victorian revaluation. What is its impact and what is its literary value in the present scenario of the society? So that was treated with a contemporary concern for the society. For example, Alfred Lord Tennyson's poem Idylls of the King, written in 1872, that was the legend was from the legend of King Arthur. But that legend, that myth, is very much treated with the contemporary concern of religious chaos, religious confusion, and religious doubts in the mind of the king. How King Arthur fixed the trouble in that myth that is redefined in terms of the present scenario or present context. So even though the the medieval myths and folklore of the romantic train was followed by the Victorian poets, the treatment of the subject matter was totally different from the romantic vision of those subjects. Then in the romantic poems we find the denouncement of all external gloss and glitter of material prosperity and wonders and mechanical progress. Even if they focused on the national prosperity or the wonders of the mechanical progress or the development of society, they never projected with through any optimistic sense of evaluation. They presented it through pessimistic, because they felt despair, they felt depressed, because they anticipated some kind of a gloomy future through the present scenario of their society. So most of the Victorian poets, they were not apprehensive of a good future or an optimistic future in their poems. So the devices, the imagery that they used in the poem, they were all describing some abstract scenes of chaos between religion and science. So no conclusion was there to derive from that confusion. So the sense of confusion, the sense of chaos, the sense of dilemma, that became a permanent feature in the Victorian poems. But significantly, when you look at the literary technique, as I was discussing a very small poem of course, that was The Brook, then you find that the drama, the literary technique is in the form of dramatic monologue. I was telling you that I is used, first person point of view is used there. Thus, the poem is presented in the autobiographical form. So in the entire poem, the speaker of the poem is an abstract element like a brook. The brook is personified there, and the brook speaks about the time by making a comparison and contrast with the previous time and anticipating the future time, because the brook has been flowing down through all these places from the time immemorial. It is not known that it is prehistoric or something like that. It has no beginning so far as its existence is concerned, or no ending so far as the existence is concerned. It is ever continuous, because that brook witnesses the events, and it is describing the events being personified by the poet through the form of a dramatic monologue. Monologue means a speech by only one person, and others will be listening to that. So here the speaker is the brook, and that dramatic monologue was the main poetic technique of Robert Browning or Alfred Lord Tennyson and other poets. So when you come to the question of main aspects of Victorian poet, then we can see that the Victorian poetry deals with the themes like realism, humanism, socialism, criticism, naturalism, and some sorts of romanticism, also intellectualism, and even philosophical ideas on feminism. And obviously they primarily base their idea on the subject of confusion.
Sir, in the Victorian age, the poetic dictions were like dictions they used?
The poetic diction was some sort of romantic, like simple diction, but in some
and the language of the poetry,
the language
like
of
the common people,
like the common people, because the target of their poet, the target of their poem was to create public awareness, public consciousness. So they meant their poem to be read by common man, because their role was to uplift the society or social activism. So obviously there, but they use some technique, like as I told you, alliteration, assonance, onomatopoeia, all those things. And the important points of those age, the poets of those age, the Victorian poets were, as you know, Alfred Lord Tennyson, Robert Browning, Matthew Arnold, then C.G. Rossetti, T.G. Rossetti, Robert Browning, and Elizabeth Barrett Browning, and Gerald Manley Hopkins, etc. and etc. So these are some of the poets who shared almost a very common trait, but of course it's slightest deviation. So when you come to the Rossetti brothers, we find that Dante Gabriel Rossetti and Christiana Rossetti, that Gabriel Rossetti's life is from 1828 to 1882, and Christiana is from 1830 to 1894. So in Gabriel's poem, we find there the honest expression of deeply felt ideals. Yes.
In which page is it?
Rossetti is, yes, there in page number 68 to 81. Okay. 68 to page 81. So in Dante Gabriel's poem, we find the honest expression of deeply felt ideals, the romanticization of the medieval past, the aesthetic and sensuous approach to art, and he was also breaking the traditional we find the poems like Goblin Market and other poems, or the Princess Progress and other poems. We find there that he was a successor of Alfred Lord Tennyson in style and theme, because his emphasis was on the Victorian ideal of womanhood. So how they were weak and how they are vulnerable in the society, that the position of women, as we discussed, they are meant for heart and heart. Similarly, when you go to Elizabeth Barrett Browning's poem, Elizabeth Barrett Browning, the wife of Robert Browning, from 1806 to 61, that in her Sonnets from the Portuguese, the love poems, she has also very much mentioned the position of women and the concept of love there by writing 51 poems on love. But her husband Robert Browning, his poem Sardello, it is given to you in page number 33 to 40. Sardello is very clearly explained in that. You may get a question on Sardello of Robert Browning in your book 8.
Yes, sir. There's a question on Sardello, like a majority of 19th century readers, including Mrs. Browning, found Sardello incomprehensible. However, for the pre-Raphaelite poets, it was a seminal text. Seminal, yes, text in the sense influenced.
Okay. So you can get the qualities of the pre-Raphaelites, how it is there. So for that reason, it was difficult for them to get.
Sir, Browning belongs to the pre-Raphaelites or Victorian poets?
High Victorian poets. Rossetti's are pre. That is
okay.
Pre-Raphaelites.
Pre-Raphaelites.
So similarly, in the poems of Alfred Lord Tennyson, who is from 1809 to 1892, the poet laureates for his lyrical poems, and significantly some of his poems like Ulysses, In Memoriam, as we discussed, then Claribel or Mariana, The Brook, we discussed, The Break, Crossing the Bar, Idylls of the King, we discussed, Maud, and lotus eaters. These are the from there. Why he chose from a wide range of subject matters, ranging from the medieval legends to classical myths, from domestic situations to observations of nature, etc. So, Tennyson is the pioneer of Victorian group of poets, and influence of John Keats can be very much felt on his literary craftsmanship, that is sensuousness, and the musical qualities that he retains in his poem. Words are there to emphasize rhythm and meanings, onomatopoeia, alliteration that we find there, and his poems are.
Sir, also, apart from onomatopoeia and onomatopoeia, there's a method like intaglio and cameo method.
Yes, that is also there.
What does that mean? I mean, those method like onomatopoeia is the verbal music. So intaglio and cameo are.
They are the two methods like almost similar to that simile and metaphor, the comparison and contrast. Because he was to make focus on the conflict between the religious faith and expanding scientific knowledge of his time. So how to make a comparison and contrast? For that he was using a lot of similarities and dissimilarities.
And how cameo is better from intaglio? There's a question also.
It is better from intaglio because it has the observation based on the scientific rationalism. But in the other case, there is not that scientific rationalism. It is just a question of the self interpretation of the poet from his own point of view. Rationalism it lacks rationalism. It is from the own point
that
of view.
That means intaglio lacks rationalism and cameo doesn't.
Yes, it has the rationalism. Okay. So through those literary features, we find a common thread of grief, melancholy, loss, depression, etc., that run through the poems of Alfred Lord Tennyson. Similarly,
hello,
Matthew.
Sir, I have a doubt about Victorian ages and High Victorian.
No. Victorian age is one. The poets of the Victorian age, they are classified under two sections, two categories: High Victorians and the Pre-Raphaelites. Most of the poets, that important poets that we discussed, they are of the High Victorians. Only the Rossettis are the Pre-Raphaelites. Pre-Raphaelites are a small group of poets. They are young poets and they dealt with the theme for art for art's sake. But the other poets, they were like social activists. They sought for social reformation. But the poems of Rossetti, they didn't aim at social reformation. They were just for the sake of pleasure. That is the basic difference. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And similarly, when you go to Matthew Arnold, that we just discussed, that Matthew Arnold instructs the readers on the contemporary social issues that we find in the Dover Beach or the Scholar Gypsy or the poem Tiresias or Sohrab and Rustam, because he has written a critical text, that is Essay on Criticism, and in that text he has very much made clear the role of a poet and the role of a reader, that how the poet has to instruct the readers through the writings, through his writings on the social issues, how the poet is a social reformer. So always Matthew Arnold poems deal with the intellectual issues of 19th century. And what are the intellectual issue? There are the corrosion of faith by doubt. The faith was corroded by, destroyed by doubt. So he repeats the same romantic melancholy, that still sad music of humanity of Wordsworth. Again, we find the sad music of humanity. The humanity has yet to recover from the sadness that was felt by the other romantic poets like Wordsworth. And the poems of Arnold always wander between the two walls. One is the previous wall, which is dead, but it is trying to dominate. Another world is the powerless world of the present, and the powerless world is aiming for a new world to burn. And in that situation, the chaotic situation, the confusion, the doubt, the confrontation that remains as the motivating factors. So he is also a kind of pessimistic poet, doesn't aspire for a better world in that kind of a situation, because to retain a conclusion is very much difficult at that situation. So he says that a strange disease of modern life that I feel, and with its sickening hurry and divided aims. The divided principles, the sickening situation of the society, and the disease of modernity that was felt in his poems. So these are some of the touching points of the Victorian poetry that we discussed for our text, that is page book 8. So I think I have given some sort of ideas or link to that book 8, and you can go through the pages that I just told you, and you can get your idea clear, because you don't have sufficient time. So it is difficult to, impossible to touch in detail all the points. So see,
the 8 classes for 10 blocks.
Yes. It's, so it's actually not at all. Because you see,
it's better for us to rather discuss the major poems and the major ages.
But you see, unless you have a clear-cut idea about the age, because yes, the sir. historical background, then the poet, then the work. So historical background is very, very important.
If you know historical background, you can connect the dots.
Yes, okay.
Can you please repeat again the major difference between pre-Raphaelite poets and High Victorian poets?
Okay, the High Victorian poets, okay, and the major difference is that High Victorian poets were writing on the subject of doubt or confusion between science and religion, and they were like social activists. They wanted to bring a social reformation through their poems. So they always focused on the contemporary issues to create an intellectual boost in the mind of the readers. They wanted to make people aware for a better society, to draw a conclusion out of this confusion. But pre-Raphaelites were a school of minor group of poets under the age of 25, and they were confined with only the aesthetic value of literature, particular art for art's sake. Means they were not interested for bringing any kind of intellectual awareness. Rather, they wanted to provide pleasure to the readers through their poems, and that is why the treatment of their poems was not based on any kind of seriousness and sincere themes of that particular age. They purportedly sought to express a new moral seriousness through their aesthetic expression of poetry. So basic thing is that when the high Victorians were very much rational in their approach, pre-Raphaelites are aesthetic.
Sir, in the post details it was mentioned it's a 64-bit program and we have 16 papers.
Yes.
In the first year we have 4 papers, and in the second year we have 6 papers or something. That's not 16 at all.
In the first year, you have 4 papers, right? And in the second year,
we have 6 or something. I saw the
second
schedule.
So
in the counseling schedule,
I'm not sure.
So, whatever remaining.
Hello, sir.
Hello. Yes.
Will there any poem is poem will come in our final exam? And for explanation,
yes, poem will come. You can get questions on a poem, get questions on a particular poet, get questions so, on a the particular age, sir, the poetic trend.
In which way we will explain that the poem?
Okay, if a poem comes, then first of all, you will know, you should know that who is the poet.
Okay, sir.
Suppose you know the poet, you should know the age to which group or to which age he belongs.
Okay, sir.
So your introduction should contain the historical, political, religious, cultural background of that age.
Okay,
and the second thing is what is the autobiographical sketch of the poet and how he was influenced by that age. Now you can come to what is poetic technique and how that poetic technique is incorporated in that particular poem that you are having in your question. So these are the three steps in that you will be answering.
Thank you very much, sir.
Okay, so
hello, sir.
Hello
sir.
Yes,
sir, question number 1. In question in examination question number 1, some stanzas will be carry. How we prepare the stanzas for poem?
Stanza, you will first see from which poem the stanza has come. Then you will refer to the poem, and once you get the poem, you can write something about the age, the quality of the poem, what is the subject matter, what is the poetic style, what is the ornamental technique, or what poetic technique has been given there. All those things will be writing. That is the explanation of the poem. The technical aspects, thematic.
Hello, sir. Another thing, yes. How we will know about the food, sir? How will that?
I have told you that only. I have told you that two types of food usually come in the exam. One is iambic, another is trochaic. Okay, so you see the book, you will get some clue how you can identify the iambic food and trochaic food. In iambic, first is unstressed, second is stressed. Trochaic is opposite. First is stressed, second is unstressed. So some words are there. If you go through the text, you will get the idea better.
Okay, sir. I am already clear. Okay.
So again, tomorrow we shall meet. For today, goodbye.